Let's talk about all those policy positions that Kamala Harris doesn't want to talk about and that she definitely is trying to run away from with our, because they've had an effect on her home state of California. Our next guest joining us to break all that down and analyze those things and more, Jonathan Williams, frequent friend of the show, executive VP of policy, chief economist at the American Legislative Exchange Council, ALEC.org. Jonathan, good afternoon. Welcome back to the Tim Jones and Chris Arp Show.
Well, hey, gentlemen, good to be back with you as always.
Jonathan, you have been highlighting something that just occurred in Kamala's California, where she was the attorney general and then she was the U.S. senator. And now we see the mighty Chevron, one of the biggest oil companies, not only in our country, but in the world. Chevron has decided to leave California. Jonathan, we can probably guess why, but do tell what led them to this departure and what effect will this have on the once mighty Golden State?
Well, it's just yet another shoe to drop, and a big one at that, when it comes to California continuing to hemorrhage its business community and its population to the other 49 states. We've tracked this, obviously, for years in our rich states, poor states report. We know, for instance, based on the net migration of individuals, that California is down roughly 350,000 in the last 12 months on that. And but yet, you know, this is a big one, and it's one that, as you both know well, if one of these major, you know, Fortune 500 companies picking up and moving its headquarters, a place that had been in San Ramon, California for decades, to Houston, Texas, is just an incredibly devastating blow to the Golden State and certainly to the community there that it once served. And, you know, most of these companies, really interesting about this announcement, many of these CEOs, as we know, especially of the publicly traded companies, are scared of their own shadow to talk about the real reasons to why they make these decisions that we know benefit their customers and workers and shareholders. But, you know, in this case, in Chevron's case, the real credit deserves to be given to the Chevron leadership as a company, as well as its CEO, Mike Wirth, who came out publicly as a part of this move and said what needed to be said, which is California became too expensive. And that's why we're leaving. And we wanted to look out for our consumers, for our employees, for our shareholders. We're doing what's right for the company. And kudos to CEO Mike Wirth for making that public announcement, because far too many businesses shy away from that, from fear of reprisal from elected officials and politicians across the country.
Jonathan, it seems that Texas has to be the top or near the top of states that are attracting businesses from high tax states like New York and California. If it is, what is number one, and what are the top three states that businesses are moving to and people?
Well, you know, Texas, Florida, two of the biggest states for inbound migration for years, individuals and businesses. And you look at even some of the larger publicly traded companies, and Texas used to not hardly even register when it comes to the headquarters of Fortune 500 companies, but it has been a absolute on rocket fuel when it comes to catching up to places like Manhattan and New York and New Jersey and other states that had long been in the lead in that category. You know, and you look at the Texas resume, it's not only just a low tax burden state, but obviously the state that avoids the personal income tax, which benefits employees and executives when they decide to move their executive leadership team and corporate headquarter relocation, such as Chevron's. But you look at the other parts of the business environment, such as the business tax, where a lot of folks forget Texas doesn't even have a traditional business income tax. It has more of a gross receipt style, a low rate tax that certainly does not have a major burden on companies like a high rate income tax like California's. And of course, Texas being a right to work state where people are not forced to join the union if they don't feel like joining the union. Obviously, they're still free to if they like, but it's not a coerced union membership state like we're seeing in many of the states that are on the outbound migration side.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of Jonathan Williams, ALEC, Executive Vice President of Policy, Chief Economist at ALEC as well. He had a huge piece highlighted on our good friends at American Journal Radio Journal last week, and he's talking about it with us now here. You know, Jonathan, how about the opposite? You know, the left and left-leaning politicians and economists will say, well, you know, you can't cut taxes, you can't reduce regulations, because that's just a recipe for disaster. Jonathan, as the author of Rich States, Poor States, along with Stephen Moore and Dr. Art Laffer for 17 years, you have multiple mountains of data now to prove that that's just not true, right? The states that lead, the states that attract people, the states that have growing populations and more prosperity are the ones that companies like Chevron want to move to, right?
Well, absolutely. And, you know, what does that mean? It means that you actually see more revenue, even if the taxes are lower. I mean, that's the basics of the Laffer curve, is that when you raise tax rates too high, like California, New York, and Illinois have over time on businesses and individuals, people leave. And, of course, what's left in as a result is major budget deficits. I mean, just look at California, where Gavin Newsom had been trumpeting the fact that on paper last year, he had a $100 billion budget surplus, thanks to the funny money and the Biden bucks coming out to California for one. But this year, because of all the mistakes, the money drying up from Washington, D.C., the out-migration, California's had tons of billions in deficit. And so it has that effect on states. When you lose these pillars of your community, you lose the revenue, you lose the jobs. And another thing that a lot of people don't spend time to think through, but it's such an important facet of this, and that is, when individuals, especially wealthy individuals, business owners, C-suite types that leave on these type of relocation decisions, not only do they take their tax revenue with them, they take their contributions to the community writ large. I know in St. Louis, you had the Bush family for years before the Bowery Company, had such great connections in civic institutions in St. Louis, and you could name so many others across Missouri. Mm-hmm. But in case of some of the high tax states, there was one that just caught my eye. Ken Griffin, who's the CEO of one of the big hedge funds, Citadel, moved its headquarters from Chicago to Miami. And it was reported recently in some of the Chicago papers that after they made that move, that Ken Griffin had given $300 million to charitable causes, but he gave it 100% of it to Miami-based charitable causes and zero to Chicago-based charitable causes. So not only do you lose the revenue impact, you actually lose some of the most important parts of building that fabric around communities.
Yeah. So I know one thing that you economists are looking at to gauge the overall health of the economy is the commercial real estate market. I know that affects banks as well. We've seen that happen in the past. Office vacancy rates reached a 20% rate in the second quarter. How worried are you about the commercial real estate market and the trouble that could cause our economy?
Well, I don't think we're out of the woods yet, for sure. Obviously, with that combined with the interest rate effect, with the inflation that we've seen from the Biden-Harris administration and the policies that drove that with the overspending, is going to continue to take its toll, not only on residential real estate and affordability of housing, but when you look at commercial real estate, the vacancies and what that's meaning for the cities. Just heard an example this week in Michigan and some of the big blue cities and some of the big blue cities across the country. You have that 20% average you just talked about. Some of the big blue cities are at 30% vacancy rate. And so it's a huge problem, not only for commerce, for consumers, but obviously when it relates to the revenue and the property taxes and everything that the cities are related on, looking at being something that keeps them afloat. So that's something that is really important to keep in mind. It's something that we need to absolutely turn around. But under the current policies coming out of Washington, D.C., I think we'll expect to see more of the same. And I think, when you get to, what a potential Harris administration would look like, I think you look in the mirror as to what the last 3.5 years have looked like under Bidenomics, and what we've seen with so many of the big problems plaguing the economy.
Mm-hmm. Jonathan, one of the other problems with California and why companies like Chevron leave is because California has exhibited zero budget restraint, as you just explained, not only over the last few years with the Biden bucks and the COVID cash, but for many, many decades, versus the states that do have proper budget restraint. Here in Missouri, we got the Hancock Amendment. Colorado has something called Tabor. Jonathan, I'm hearing a lot of our Missouri legislators start talking about Tabor. Maybe it's because many of them were just at the ALEC meeting in Colorado. As crazy as Colorado has become, they do have something called the Taxpayer Bill of Rights that has prevented Colorado from being completely overwhelmed by the Californians who are fleeing California and moving to Colorado. Jonathan, why should Missouri consider a Tabor Act, a Taxpayer Bill of Rights?
Well, I think one of the most positive steps that any state can take to protect its hardworking taxpayers from the government overspending, exactly like we've seen in California. And in fact, some of my friends in Colorado that we were with at the Allocan meeting tell us that TABOR, the Taxpayer Bill of Rights in Colorado, has been really the one thing that's in its constitution as a protection against overspending and overtaxing. It's the one thing that's kept California from exporting all of its bad ideas, as all of its people have migrated to Colorado and surrounding states. Mm-hmm. It's really kept Colorado from becoming California East. And what that is it basically puts a common sense cap that government spending and government tax revenue cannot grow faster than the economy, can't grow faster than population plus inflation. And it's something that over 30 years now being in Colorado's constitution has been an incredible dividend where when revenue goes up above that limit, guess what? Automatically, that money gets refunded back to taxpayers really as a dividend of this stopping of overspending. And it's been something as Colorado has transitioned politically from being really red to purple down to blue. Colorado's TABOR has remained popular. It was just on the ballot this last fall, I think was you talked about, where voters went in and actually said by a 60-40 margin, we want to keep Colorado's TABOR in its constitution, even as the big spending interests were putting up millions to try to repeal it. So it's got an incredible political pull, but more importantly, it has really kept Colorado in fine shape when it comes to the economy. Otherwise, you know, we would see some really progressive spending and tax policies over the last decade.
Jonathan, both Vice President Harris and former President Trump have proposed ending federal taxes on tips income. There's been a liberal think tank that said that would cost the government $100 to $200 billion a year. Your thoughts on that proposal?
Well, you know, I'm not as worried about it costing government. Government is just fine in terms of hitting record revenue in recent years. And it doesn't we don't have our problems because we tax too little in Washington or in many states. However, I think that it's a good discussion to have that we're talking about what the role of taxation is and what the cost of government is on the average take-home pay of workers. And that's an important discussion. It's an important thing to highlight. It's an important thing for everybody to remember. As we talk to individuals coming into the workforce, you know, they wonder why the stated salary isn't the salary that they get on their first paycheck. And of course, that's the burden of government. It's a big burden. And we should never forget that. I do think there, when you look at the proposals, you have to be careful that people wouldn't game the system, right? I mean, I think there's a real problem potentially where you're going to have a whole lot of tip income and not a lot of wage income in a scenario like that if you tax everybody at extremely high rates on wages and nothing on tips. And so you just have to look for the unintended consequences. But I'm really glad that we're having the discussion about how much government takes out of our hard-earned paychecks, and we need to be talking more about that and how to get that burden down.
Amen.
We have been speaking with Jonathan Williams. He is the chief economist. He's executive vice president of policy at ALEC. ALEC.org is where you can read more about Chevron leaving California due to high taxes and high regulations, leaving all that behind for the Lone Star State. Jonathan, thanks so much for everything, for the great analysis and insight as always. It's always a pleasure to speak with you.
Always great to be with you, gentlemen.